it just means that the bubble now is at least 3 times as big, and the risk is about probably 20 times as big, much bigger than the size of the debt. You know, it goes up exponentially, the risk. So this, now we are in a situation where I don't think the system can be saved this time. So.
Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you and of course Matt Piepenburg and Egon von Dreyerz here at Forum One in the Sofitel Munich. Egon, Matt, it's a pleasure to have you both here, both together, because if we talk other times, we have you separately.
Yeah. Well,
it's a pleasure to have you here, both. Yeah. How do you like the new show so far? What is your impression, Egon?
Well, I think it's great. You know, this is, for us, excellent also. Edelmetallmesse was very good, but it was now it's the more type of investor that suits our company. So I think it's well organized, and we're very pleased with the setup here.
Thank you. Egon, let's come to the topics that we always discuss.
Yeah.
You talk about the 70s. When you go back to, say, the year 2000, around the time when you started your Matterhorn business, did you expect back then that the bubble of all bubbles would go to such an extent and last that long? Or did you think it should have been popped long ago?
No, the thing is, in life, when you see a problem, you think it's going to happen now because you see it. But I've learned, you know, one of the things I've learned in a long life is you have to have patience. So, you know, we were right with the system being not quite bankrupt, but in trouble. And we were right about the debts and the derivatives and all of that. And it was right to buy gold at that time when we went heavily into gold in 2002 at $300. But of course, the world didn't collapse at all, thankfully, I would say. So gold went up for 10, 11 years to 850 in 2011. But of course, we had in between there, we had a crash. Well, we first had the dot-com crash around 2000, and then we had the banking crash and the subprime crash in 2008, or 6 to 9, if you want. So you know, the crashes are there. It's just that skillfully, and it was a miracle almost, the banks managed to make the system survive by injecting hundreds of trillions of fake money. So. It's taken longer than I expected, but it just means that the bubble now is at least 3 times as big, and the risk is about probably 20 times as big, much bigger than the size of the debt. You know, it goes up exponentially, the risk. So this, now we are in a situation where I don't think the system can be saved this time. So.
Matt, if we go back to 2011, the gold price was close to $2,000, 2011, and of course, people argue, you warned the people for a long time, and now basically we are at the same gold price as back then. But you know, the situation is much worse. We saw the banking crisis in the USA and the gold price at this level. What do you think is the reason for gold being there where it is now?
Well, it's unlike 2011, we're running out of ammunition. We're running out of easy solutions that are credible anymore. There was still some kind of faith that the central banks had our back, that our debt levels were sustainable, that our bond markets were viable, that our central bankers were believable. This time around, as we're hitting the same price level we saw in 2011, all of those things are already broken. And it's not an exaggeration, it's not sensational anymore. The U.S. Treasury is the most important state, you know, Staatsbund, or, you know, U.S. our sovereign bond in the world, and it's falling in price by 20 cents on the 10-year and 50 cents on the 30-year. It's created a banking crisis. It's created a sovereign bond market crisis that is spreads to Europe, as we saw in the gilt crisis last year. So you've got a banking crisis, a bond crisis. You've got a central bank that's no longer in control of inflation, despite all their best efforts to say so. So unlike 2011, to your point, Jan, all of our simple tricks and our fancy words are no longer believable in terms of psychological trust, and certainly no longer believable in terms of the mathematics of what we're seeing in the markets and the yields and the spiking yields and tanking bond prices. And when yields spike, interest rates go up. When interest rates go up, the cost of debt goes up. Debt is the wind, the rotten wind beneath the wings of our so-called recovery. And when that debt is too expensive, everything breaks. And that's not sensational anymore. And the more people understand that, the more they'll understand why they feel this pain, why they feel this inflation, why they feel this distrust. Well, the math's already supporting it. It's just sadly what it is.
Egon, the question that we also hear from time to time, why are not more people taking precautions? We spoke about it in our interviews. The numbers are the numbers as we read it, and we see the problems in the banks, the derivative pyramid. Still, many big investors also, they seem absolutely to be clueless about what is ahead of them. Is this right or a wrong impression?
Well, no, it's totally right, since only 0.5% of world financial assets are invested in gold. Nobody, it's like the biggest secret in the world. No, nobody understands gold. Nobody owns gold, virtually. And for the small investor, you know, he's being misled by governments by never telling him that the money in your pocket is going down every day by a certain percentage. And over a period of like last 50 years, it's gone down by 97%, your money. But normal people are not being told that because for them, it's just inflation. It's not that the value of money goes down. It's that they think that just products go up in price, which is totally wrong. Okay. It's their money that's going down because too much money is printed. That's for the private investors. And then if you take for institutions, Jan, it's been so easy for institutions and for professional investors to make money in the last 50 years or 20 years, whatever period you take, because everything has just gone up and up and up. Whenever there's been a problem or a crash, it's always been saved by the central banks by printing more money and more money until it now is going exponential, the money printing. But people think that stocks grow to heaven and bonds go to heaven and property market goes to heaven, and corrections are always temporary. They're going to get the shock of their lifetime in the next few years, whether that's 5 years or longer, it doesn't matter. The risk is now greater than ever in history, and that's what investors should worry about, small ones and big ones. On top of that, we'll of course have more inflation, more money printing, because everybody, as Matt said, everybody is now running bigger deficits than ever, especially the world reserve currency, dollar and the US government. So we are going to have a problem in the world, a big problem, and that's why people should think about protecting it. But so far, they're not.
And the case is also, if you go back past 25 years or so, we had the Russia crisis, the Asia crisis, real estate bubble in the USA. Those were separate crises, but now you have all together at once. Is there any asset that is not at risk now? The stock markets are still elevated. The real estate market is already coming down, not everywhere. The bond markets, that's obvious. So in previous times, you could switch your money. You could go out of the real estate, move into bonds, but there is no place to go now other than gold, right?
Ironically, and again, people will say, you're talking your book, you're exaggerated gold, you're a gold bug, you're a gold bear, a bull. This is just you with your bias. But look, it's much, much more than that. Again, we all have the right to our own opinions. We don't have the right to our own facts. And the facts are, even Eastern central banks and other central banks that have been importing U.S. inflation and buying U.S. treasuries up until 2014, since 2014, even those central banks are net sellers of the U.S. treasury and they're net buyers of physical gold. That's not something they called Matterhorn to get our opinion on. They did that naturally because they're not going into sovereign bonds. They're not going into risk assets. They're not even going into commercial real estate. They're going into that barbarous old relic, physical gold, that we talk about because we're gold bulls. No, it's just because common sense. As Egon said, it's not that gold just keeps getting secretly stronger. It's all those other assets that were traditionally trusted are getting weaker and weaker and debased because we've been living well over our skis in debt for over a generation. And the central bankers no longer have the magical words or the magical money to solve the problem. And that's not a gold bug argument. It's history and common sense.
Mm-hmm. And now if you go to the US central bank, they solved all problems with more mouse click money, as you always say. Yeah. But right now it seems they still have not come back to the quantitative easing. They are not doing that yet. You see the money supply mm-hmm. coming down. Mm-hmm. I could have the impression that they want to create an accident. What's your
opinion? Well, I'll just interrupt because there has been quantitative easing. It's just not official. We had the BTFP program to bail out the failed banks of 2023. Last August or last October, September, Janet Yellen at the Treasury used the TGA account to bail out other to create other liquidity. And then we basically, without making the headlines, all those bonds that sunk those banks in the U.S. that lost 20 cents or 50 cents on the dollar from the 10 to the 30 year, well, the Fed basically gave them, guaranteed them the par value of those bonds. That was behind the scenes liquidity salvation. That was a behind the scenes bailout that no one's talking about. Again, not sensational, but so there has been backdoor liquidity, just not an official pivot. But again, these are the small steps towards an eventual surrender to just outright liquidity. And that will only happen when the stock market, which is now led by seven companies, basically, when that finally falls, the recession, the pain that we're seeing everywhere else will then become headlines. Until then, they'll just use, as they always do, you know, nice words to replace really bad math. And that's my view on that.
Let's give our audience some recommendations. Egon, if you have old money, families that worked for generations that have money, real estate, bonds or stocks, and maybe they see the seriousness of this crisis coming, what should they do? And Matt, to you, similar question, if you are Joe Sixpack and you have a good sense of reality, what should you do for the bigger and the normal investor?
Of course, if you're talking about really old money, generation, big families that have been wealthy for generations, of course, you know, the common rule is one third property, or especially land, of course, so the, you know, and one third gold and one third art. That's what they hold. And you know, over time, if you think about generational wealth, that will still hold. You know, obviously land prices will come down a bit now, but they've gone up a lot, and art prices also will come down because the rich will not be able to afford to pay the high prices of all art that we see now. But nevertheless, over time, that's a wonderful portfolio, but that assumes that you have land and you can live off the land, etc. So that's for the really wealthy. But for normal people, or normal wealthy people who don't have a lot of land, I believe that they should switch it out of stocks now and switch into gold. Because, I mean, if you look at just the ratio between stocks or stock markets and gold, it's so clear that that ratio is going to crash in favor of gold, i.e. gold go up and stocks go down by a big percentage, 70-80% or more. So that's a simple rule. Sadly, people will not do it because they're too used to owning stocks and owning bonds and owning property. They will only react when it's very late, sadly.
Yeah, and as far as Joe Sixpack, it's an even sadder story. I mean, because they're getting clobbered by the invisible tax of inflation and then the visible pain of higher rates and the higher cost of everything from their credit cards to their car loans, which, by the way, are defaulting at massive levels around the world, but in particular in the U.S. It's easy to say, well, even Joe Sixpack can go out and buy some gold coins and we could just keep falling on that. But I know that realistically, most of them are just trying to get through the month and worried about whether they're going to keep their job. And then I think my advice to them, look, this is not the time. My children's generation in their 20s, 26, 27, 28, middle class, they're thinking, I got to get rich quick. That's not the generation. It's not the world that we grew up in. It's not going to be that easy. I think my advice to Joe Sixpack is not to be naive, not to believe all the headlines, good or bad, but this is not the time to be chasing tops in an overvalued stock market. It's not the time to be taking massive amounts of risk in sketchy commodities or certainly sketchy cryptos. Not necessarily for or against cryptos, but be careful. If you're willing to take that risk, can you really afford to? Sometimes doing nothing when the evidence is all around you that things are bad is the hardest thing to do. And yeah, you can't always beat inflation sometimes, but if you take more risk in a risk parity portfolio of diversified stocks and diversified bonds, you're just gonna have more losses to your already inflationary high debt losses. So I think it's hard, it's very hard. It's like combat, it's 90% boredom and 10% excitement. Sometimes the markets, you have to just be defensive, not offensive, and wait for this market to mean revert, nobody knows when, and buy low. In the interim, have your eyes wide open about these risks and don't fall for every gimmick that's out there on the get-rich-quick scheme, because that world is not today. It just isn't. Sadly, for the majority of the Joe Sixpacks, they'll be lucky if they can just keep their jobs and they're not even beat inflation, but at least they keep it inflation. I don't think there's an easy asset class for that group of people, really, other than the knowledge of not being naive and being realistic, and I can say vote for better policymakers or vote for a better scenario, but unfortunately, it's just not that easy.
But normal people, of course, they don't have a lot of investments or asset. So therefore, number one, in my view, think about to whatever extent you can reduce your debt. That's number one. You don't want to be dependent on the bank. Number two, everybody can save for buy a little bit of gold. You know, you can buy a few grams of gold a month, for example.
Or silver.
Or silver, yeah, which you can buy a lot more of, exactly. And, you know, if the people in Venezuela had done that 20 years ago, they would have survived easily and had a reasonable life, had enough food, etc. And now they're all suffering tremendously. So what people don't realize that even buy, you know, don't buy that last, whatever, pack of cigarettes or whatever, or the beer. You know, buy a little bit of gold every month, and that will be your savior when things really go bad. But sadly, most people don't understand the importance of that. But that's what normal people should do, really.
Therefore, we do our interviews monthly to educate the people and to get at least some more to take precautions. Egon and Matt, it was a pleasure to talk to you today.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
It was a pleasure.
Enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.